Thank you, Dr. Edgar. At the outset, let me just preface my presentation by thanking Dr. Edgar for inviting me over to this seminal event here in Brazil. It's my first trip to the country, and I truly am enjoying being here, and I hope to come back many times in the future. Let me also compliment Dr. Salunke for launching his journal. I think it's a very commendable step, and I hope that from the realm of scholarship, it can expand to public policy making as well, and to be able to interface two societies to make things better. Now, let me begin by interrogating two concepts, because they are central to my particular theme, and that is asymmetric warfare and human security. Yep. Now, basically what I'm dealing with is the issue of Naxal violence. Now, I'll be going to that a little later. Let me first interrogate the two concepts of asymmetric warfare and human security. We all know that in the last two decades, the world has essentially seen the advent of globalization. And globalization essentially has created two dichotomous kind of concepts. On the one hand, the world is a more integrated and a more connected and more interdependent place. At the same time, it has also made identity politics very important, and therefore the world has also seen fragmentation. So policymakers have to take that into account. Now, when I say asymmetric warfare, I'm essentially focusing on the very fact that over the last two decades, this period has also coincided with a change in the nature of warfare. From 1648, which is essentially the sovereign state system after the Westphalian Order, we have essentially known warfare to be a state subject, and therefore an interstate subject. However, in the last two decades, we've seen a proliferation of intrastate wars, that is, wars happening within the territorial boundaries of a country. However, they have very important spillover effects into neighboring countries. So that's one aspect. Now, what is asymmetric warfare? Asymmetric warfare is warfare between two sides which don't really have a certain symmetry. That means a certain balance. So you have a conventional standing army of the state on the one hand, and you have subnational or non-state actors, as we call them, small groups or militias, who essentially operate through stealth, through guerrilla tactics, and through what is called as a battle of attrition, trying to sap into the morale of a standing army. The thing about asymmetric warfare is there's no end game to it. A simple example. Not too many years ago, President Bush could stand up aboard one of his aircraft carriers and say, "Mission accomplished." He said that in the context of what he felt was America concluding combat operations in Iraq. However, as we speak, even until yesterday, bombs are still going off in Baghdad, and the civil war is showing no signs of abating. So there are no red lines, there are no end games when it comes to asymmetric warfare. It's an ongoing battle that we have to fight. And what is human security? Today's battles are not about territorial gains. Today's battles are essentially about what happens to innocent men, women, and children when conflict erupts. So in that context, I'm going to talk about how an insurgent movement in India, which has been in place for almost four and a half decades, has taken its toll on human security, and what kind of challenges it places before the Indian state as the Indian state tries to overcome it. So that's basically what I'm going to deal with. Now, when we talk about South Asia, the history of South Asia is one where nation-building process has been fragile and incomplete. And that's largely because, on the one hand, we have had extreme poverty, underdevelopment. On the other hand, we've had religious, ethnic, and sectarian strife. Both of these have come together and created a situation where nation-building in the real sense of the term has not taken place. So even though you have sovereign states the state's national boundaries are very porous, and therefore they have consequences for neighboring states. So when a certain destabilizing situation happens in one state, unless the neighboring state safeguards itself, there is a very big chance this could spill over into the other. Of course, since 9/11, South Asia, unfortunately, has also become the epicenter of terror. Okay. Now, the problem arises is because of the geopolitics of South Asia. That is the geography of South Asia. If you look very carefully, this is India. And around India, you have a host of countries of South Asia. Some are named, some are not named here. But the interesting fact of geography that exists in South Asia is that India, the largest country, shares a border with every other South Asian country, a land border or a maritime border, which means that in whatever happens in any part of South Asia, India is going to be impacted. That impact could be conscious, that impact could be uncalled for. So if something happens in a neighboring country, the ethnic implications can spill over into India's boundaries. Or if there is some kind of a terrorist movement or a subversive movement, they could infiltrate into India's borders. So India has to guard against multiple borders. And that is one of the handicaps of geography. Now, as you can see in this particular slide, there are a whole host of insurgent or subversive movements across the country. However, I'm going to focus on the Naxal movement. Now, what really is the Naxal movement? Now, the Naxal movement actually is also called the Maoist movement. It's actually a very generic term that refers to a movement that draws its inspiration on the ideology of Maoism and believes that there has to be a systemic change to the politics in India. Only then issues of development, issues of economic disparity can be redressed. Now, the Naxal movement has its inception in 1967 in a place called Naxalbari in West Bengal. However, when this movement had its inception, the context was a specific one, and that was the issue of land reform. Because, you know, you need to understand that land has had two connotations in India. One, if you have land, you have a certain standing in society. You may not have hard cash, but if you are landed, if you have property, then you obviously have a certain exalted standing in society. And as a result of that, it gives you political power, or at least access to political power, because you are able to influence with your proximity to the powers that be, you are able to influence decision making. And the political powers as well are unable to exercise themselves independent of these landed people. The state from which I come from in India also, which is Goa, has seen this. How a few landed families can influence the politics of that particular region. So this Naxal movement, which first began in 1967, began with the idea that there has to be urgent land reform. That the land distribution is so inequitable, so disparate, that there is no power in the hands of the landless, those who till the land, those who farm the land. Okay? So to redress that, out of the Marxism movement in India came out the wing called the Naxals. It's actually an offshoot of the Marxist movement in India. But this is an offshoot which is a very radical one. It came out with the understanding there can be no dialogue, there can be no negotiation with the Indian state. There has to be an overthrow of the Indian state and bringing in a new set of policies or measures which can address the situation. However, within a period of 5 or 6 years, the Indian government was able to subjugate and suppress this particular movement, with its pioneers and leaders essentially either being arrested or being killed. And the movement seemed to fade away very quickly out of public memory. Actually, if I were to look at the last 45 years of this so-called Naxal movement, I can identify three distinct phases. The first phase I call as the phase of inception, when a new idea comes to the fore. A new idea is trying to make its way into people's imagination. This happened in the 60s and probably the 70s. Through the 80s and the 90s was what I call as a period of regrouping, where a certain ideological movement is now being tested. Can it sustain itself? Can it come up with new ideas? Can it reorient itself and become a new avatar, as we call it, a new form? So the 1980s and the 90s was a period when that particular movement was trying to regroup. And since the turn of the century, till about 2012-13, we have seen a period of consolidation where this particular movement has become very, very combative, very, very aggressive, and extremely violent. So I see it in those three phases. Now, when we talk about this particular situation, let's look at how the state has responded to it. It's often a fact that whenever a subversive movement comes into being, the state tries to talk down the movement, saying it's a very simple problem. And so the initial response of the state was to treat it as a mere law and order problem. And so we can deal with it very easily. However, the fact that this particular movement has been around for 45 years definitely shows that probably it is doing some things right, and probably it is exploiting the weaknesses of the Indian system. Now, why am I even discussing, or why have I singled out the Naxal movement? There are many such insurgent movements, not only in India but around the world, but nowhere has the movement been able to not only sustain but expand itself to the territory that it has done in India. In fact, latest estimates show that the movement probably has expanded to about 35% of India's districts. Now, India administratively is divided into about 632 districts across the entire country. These are administrative units. Almost 200 of them are impacted by this insurgent movement called the Naxal or the Maoist movement. Now, it's not that all 200 are heavily infested. Some are heavily impacted, some are less impacted. But up to 200 districts are such where the authority of the government, either of the central government or the state government, is not effective, but the manner in which the Naxals operate is more effective. It amounts to something like 92,000 square kilometers, which is huge. Okay, so we have to consider it. Secondly, we have to also consider it because, as I said, the Indian state has seen certain insurgency movements in the northeast of India. If I may go back to the map again, the northeast part of India, around Nepal and going into the extreme. But those have been largely because of issues of autonomy, more freedom, or on issues of ethnicity. The Maoist movement has nothing to do either with autonomy or with ethnicity. It's clearly a case where they want to overthrow the government in Delhi. They want to overthrow the political system that exists in India, i.e., they want to essentially overthrow democracy in India. So you have to single them out and look at them as a much more serious threat than any other insurgent movement. That's number one. And number two, you also have to look at it as a very serious problem, because if you see the numbers are quite huge. If you see just between 2003 and 2009, the number of incidents in a particular year are staggeringly high, anywhere from 1,600 to 2,300 incidents every year. And those incidents kill many. So if you look at the impact it is having on the security situation in the country, this is a threat that has to be appreciated, and this is a threat which also has to be dealt with. Okay. Now, as I said, for a long time, the Indian state was trying to brush it aside and overlook this particular problem. But in the last 10, 12 years, this has just not been possible. Because even in India's democratic discourse, the issue of development and governance has become central to Indian politics. In fact, in the first 20, 30 years of India's democratic polity, voting preferences were hardly determined by issues of development. They were essentially driven by sensational and emotive issues. So the government of the day could win back terms after terms after terms in office by appealing to the sensitivities of individuals. In the next 20 years, you had something called as anti-incumbency. That means if the government did not deliver, they would be kicked out and the opposition would be brought into power. Not because the people of India believed that the opposition could do any better, but because they felt that we've given you a chance, now we'll give somebody else a chance. However, in the last 10-15 years, India has seen a very positive development in its democracy. And that is a kind what is called as positive incumbency, which means wherever people see a government delivering on issues of governance, on development, they are willing to vote that government back into office and back again and back again. Now, this is definitely an eye-opener to governments across India, not just the federal government, but also regional governments. And so even the issue of the Naxal movement or the Maoist movement, which essentially drives on underdevelopment, has become a very important one. The government has begun to appreciate that there are areas in the country where there is gross underdevelopment, there is a lot of exploitation, there is lack of basic human rights or a violation of those human rights, and that is causing this particular movement to become a kind of a replacement in the eyes of the people. Okay, now what has the government done? Now often when governments think of such movements, the initial tendency is to look at such movements as being a security problem, a military problem. So you basically deploy forces and try and crush the movement. The Indian government has tried that, and obviously the Indian government has failed. So it requires something more than just a military solution. And today, often, socio-economic problems do not have military solutions. Military can be one element of the solution, it can't be the solution. And so the solution needs something more. And so, in 2009, the Indian government came out with what is called as the Integrated Action Plan. After much thinking on the issue, they came out with this plan, which has two elements. The first element is a typical law and order security issue, which has to be dealt with. But the second is the need for socio-economic integration. That means appreciating the fact that there is a need to do more in areas of underdevelopment, to do more in terms of equitable distribution of resources, economic resources, to do politics which is more consensual, which is more people-oriented, and that is the long-lasting and sustainable way by which the Maoist movement probably can be defeated. So what has the government done? Now let's remember one thing. India is a federal country, and under the constitution, the law and order is considered to be a state subject. That means, unless an act is declared as an act of terrorism, it is an issue for the state or the province within India where it's happening to deal with, not the federal government. This is one issue. And so the tendency often is to leave this issue to be dealt with by the respective state government or the provincial government. However, the Naxal movement is not limited to one state. In fact, it expands across anywhere between 12 to 16 states of the country, again at varying degrees. There are about 6 or 7 states where it's huge, and I'm going to show that map as we go forward. But across 16 states. Now that calls for coordination. It's more than half the country. Now if these 16 states have to be dealt with, there has to be integration between the federal government and a lot of state governments. So that calls for problems. Secondly, states are ill-equipped to deal with problems that essentially go across different states. So for instance, you can attack in one state and you can disappear into another state and you will have invariable problems. The other problem is a problem of polity. In India, unlike in many other mature democracies, we have a whole host of political parties. In fact, the Election Commission puts the number at 1,200 political parties. It's not that every political party has a seat in government, but 40 to 50 political parties are represented in India's parliament. And increasingly in the last 10, 15 years, a lot of the state governments are being run by regional parties, not national parties. So the problem is, if you have to develop a coordinated strategy, it's very difficult if 16 heads, which all look different, who think different, have to come and sit around a table and they have to say, okay, let's agree on a certain situation, because everyone has a different idea. And so how do 16 ideas, you know, encompass and become one idea? Apart from that, there's another problem. In two or three of these states, these Naxal and Maoist movements have begun giving under the cover or quiet support to certain political parties to come to power. So there is a vested interest of some political parties to keep the Naxal movement going, because it is their back office operation. And there is one state, particularly in Jharkhand, which is again in eastern India, where actually, and you can see the states here, these are by and large the states where the Naxal movement is there. At various levels, you can see highly affected, moderately affected, and marginally affected states, going by the colors. There are about 58 highly affected districts, 54 moderately affected, and marginally affected are about 83. And these numbers go on changing. But if you see some of these states, I'm talking about Jharkhand, as you can see there, it's mentioned. Now, that's a state which was formed 11 years ago. It's a state that faces tremendous political turmoil. Governments don't last for more than a year or 2 years, almost like in Israel, where governments keep falling every second year. And the Naxal movement has been able to co-opt certain political parties on the strength of whom they're able to continue with their movement. So again, there's another problem. Now, so the Indian government has begun to appreciate that there is a two-fold strategy. This is the Prime Minister of India addressing two sets of meetings. One is a meeting which is a conference of chief ministers on internal security. And one is where he's essentially dealing with a workshop that deals with socio-economic development measures that need to be dealt with. Okay. So as I told you, the center looks at the problem essentially as a law and order situation. And so they leave it to the states. In some cases, you don't even know whom to deal with. One of the major problems with the Naxal movement is, unlike what people think that it is a movement with a clear chain of command, it's not like that. There are as many as 150 odd groups who call themselves Maoists, who happen to operate in and around these 14, 16 states. So even if you have to dialogue with them, whom to dialogue with? Whom to negotiate with? So there's a problem of leadership. They're all motivated by a movement to overthrow the government, but the government would not know whom to deal with. This is what we call as the Red Corridor. Now this is what I'm coming to. This is where national security and external security kind of merge. You can see Nepal, which is an independent country, and where the Maoist movement has been in existence for a long, long time. It's been looking to overthrow the government. Now, finally, after the disbanding of the monarchy, it has come into government. However, the problem is there has been a red corridor that's been formed. As you can see, right from Nepal, the fringes of Nepal, right down to parts of Tamil Nadu and even Kerala. And this entire stretch is marked in red. This is considered to be the high intensity zone for the Naxal operations. And they're essentially able to thrive on socio-economic exploitation. Now, an important point that arises, is it a coincidence that the areas where the Naxals are strong or the Maoists are strong are also India's most impoverished region? If you look at India in terms of geographical map, the position in red are some of the poorest states of India in terms of GDP. They ought not to be, because the paradox is that although they are the poorest regions of India, they have deposits of 85% of India's natural resources. So it's an issue of governance, as you can see. It's a governance deficit. 85% of natural resources of India are in all these states. And yet these states are not the frontline states of economic growth. That's because the manner in which policies have been introduced have led to exploitation of natural resources without giving the local people their due. The tribals, for instance, the indigenous people, for instance, have at times been driven out of their homes without adequate packages of relocation. So what happens is, when they are driven to an absolute situation of desperation, they feel that the government doesn't listen to them. They don't have a voice in government. And so then they turn automatically to subversive movements like the Maoists. However, in 2010, the situation began to change for the better. And that's because, after appreciating the need for a two-pronged approach, namely a security situation scenario and also a socio-economic scenario, in 50-60 districts of India, the situation has begun to change. And it's begun to change because some of it is the Maoists' own undoing. In 2010, they had an ambush and they killed 76 policemen in a state called Chhattisgarh, as you can see here, which today is one of the states of epicenter of Maoism. Now, when you kill a large number of people, even though they may be secretly people, you don't send a positive message, because the people feel that innocent people are unnecessarily being killed. The 76 policemen who were ambushed when they were on patrol was the most audacious attack by the Naxals ever. But since then, the extent to which they have been killing people whom they feel are against them has actually begun to alienate some of the people from them and has driven the Naxals into a certain amount of frustration. Having said that, the same state of Chhattisgarh, which today is infested by the Maoist problem to the largest extent, tried a very controversial step in 2009. It's called Salwa Judum. S-A-L-W-A-J-U-D-U-M. Salwa Judum. It's, in English, the equivalent is purification hunt, as they call it. Now, what is this Salwa Judum? The government thought the best thing to fight them is, as they say in English, if you want to clean up some dirt, you got to roll up your sleeves and get dirty. You can't stay on the edge and say, I want to clean the dirt. So the government felt, if you want to tackle the Naxals, why not bring the tribals into action and turn them against the Naxals? So young people were brought in, young youth were brought in, and they were trained and made special police officers and put on duty, because they are best conversant with the terrain in which the Naxals operate. And so they can supplement the government's efforts to crush the Naxal movement. Now, this may be innovative, but it's a very dangerous step. Because what the government did, the state government in Chhattisgarh, is they actually gave arms. Now, under the constitution, it is unconstitutional for any state government or any government to create militias, because weapons are to be used only by the government. The government is not to create militias to fight militias. The matter went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court of India, and this is where you see a positive element of democracy. Even though the Supreme Court knows that the Salwa Judum has paid dividends in terms of the government being succeeding in reducing the Naxal violence, they went in on an issue of principle, and they said, disband Salwa Judum immediately. It is unconstitutional for the state government to create private militias to fight a subversive element. If you have shortcomings, do not try and deflect attention by creating private militias. So this is a very important aspect. However, in recent times, there have been extremely large attacks on innocent people done by the Naxals, by the Maoists. And this, in a sense, is leaving people to wonder as to whether the Naxals really represent their cause, or are they cannon fodder in the hands of the Naxals who want to overthrow the Indian state. So what are the solutions? Is there a solution? There is no perfect solution, because when you're dealing with an element that wants to overthrow you, you can't negotiate. There is no place to negotiate. You can only negotiate if there is common ground. But overthrow of a federal government is not a point of negotiation. On the other hand, there is definitely cause for government policies to be modulated, for resource allocation to be taking place, and for resources to be equitably distributed between the people. So in a sense, actually, the people are in a predicament, and they're wondering. On the one hand, there is a state which has shown keen interest in revising policy. On the other hand, you have the Naxals and the Maoists who have been wanting to overthrow the government but are also very ruthless in how they operate. So basically, I will leave the issue open, and I'll basically want to answer more questions basically by saying that this is a problem which is a serious security problem. It's a problem which has socio-economic underpinnings. It's a problem to which the government of the day is sensitive. But as I said, it is a very complex problem, and it's a war of attrition. And as we discussed in the morning with regard to sport, whether we can actually recover the brand image of sport, I don't think one can set a kind of a deadline or an end game and say, by this time, this particular movement will be over. The only realistic way of ending the movement is by reducing the distortions, reducing the inequality that exists. And that is the lasting way by which such insurgencies will die their own death. So I think I'll leave it with this, and I'll probably answer more questions when they're here. Thank you.